the Martin Segal Theatre Center here at the Graduate Center of CUNY. My name is Frank Henschel. I'm the Executive Director and Director of Programs. And thank you for taking the time to come so shortly after the Easter break in Europe. This is the Easter Monday, which would be a day of no working in Greece. It would be 10 days of not celebration. And so that's always when we have sometimes a little smaller house, but everybody who's here are real supporters, so we always feel this is a core family. So thank you for taking time out of your life. We need a good theater, but we also really need a good audience and that dialogue. Tonight we have a very special event. It's about Amelia Hertz, kind of forgotten, lost, and only recently rediscovered Polish playwright from the 20s and 30s. And we will hear much more about her in a minute. And we would like to thank, first of all, Jadwiga Kosicka, who is here with us, the translator of the plays in the collection. And does anybody have the book handy? We can hold it up. Was it outside? Yeah, here it is. This is, and normally it's, I think, 20 or 25, so tonight you could get it for $10. Amelia Hertz happened to be the aunt of Jan Kott, which also he didn't know, a great, significant Polish theater, a thinker, actually one of the great in the world, and his Shakespeare books, Eating Gods, and others are really of significance. And we are truly honored to host this first reading, most probably in the Americas, perhaps ever. We don't really know. Jadwiga will tell a little bit more and also about her life. And it's a special day also for us, Daniel Gerald, who was the executive director of the Segal Center, a wonderful colleague and a great, great friend, and we miss him dearly. It's his birthday today. He also was a very strong supporter of this project, and after it was supposed to be published in London by a publishing house that went under, and then we took this over. So the evening will have the following schedule. It will be a small introduction by one of the supporters of the evening. This is Agata Grenda, who is the director of the Polish Cultural Institute in New York. So thank you for coming, and Tomek, also like one of the curators of the Polish Cultural Institute. It just shows how significant this writer really is. Jadwiga will give a few remarks. I hope you are mic'd up and have everything to give us a little bit of context about this truly unusual woman, very early on in the feminist sense. You know, she was a pioneer, I think, and it is only time that her work gets recognized, and also it is truly the first reading of her plays, and I think it's a great honor also for the Segal Center to be the host. It will be followed by an introductory essay, Isolde of the White Hands. This will be read by Jon Krupp, who's one of the actors of tonight, so to give a little bit more of context to this quite exquisite play which we're going to hear, The Isolde of the White Hands, which has been directed by Jane House, who is here with us, who studied also here at the Graduate Center of CUNY, worked for the Graduate Center, but also as a professional actress and has for a small theater company, a fine one that does specialized in readings, actually most of them Italian. And it will be followed by a small discussion here afterwards, and we have a little drink as a small reception here in the room, so if you have some additional questions, that would be all answered. Again, thank you all for coming. If you have a cell phone, I'll listen. So maybe even you, I don't know. Yeah. So take it out, do the same, take your time. It should say ring or silent. It does, everyone. And it never rings in our, it's really true, in all of our evenings, it has never happened, so it shouldn't be this evening. And now again, a great friend, a great colleague, I think one of the great leaders of a cultural institution here in New York. We have over 10 years worked with many, many. And there were one or two great ones. There was Emmanuel de Montgazon, the French Cultural Services, and Ignacio from the Spanish cultural one, but Agata is one of the two or three really, really great ones, and we're so happy that you're back and the help of the Polish Cultural Institute, and it's a great testament also to the country of Poland that they have you here representing them. So thank you for coming, and here we go.
Good evening. Thank you so much, Frank, for all your nice words, and I'm very happy to be back here at Martin Segal Theatre Center. I'm director of Polish Cultural Institute in Lviv, but I was here as deputy director there in 2006, 2011, where, and I also served at that time as theater curator, and we had some great events here at CUNY with Daniel Gerald, and I'm very happy to be here on his birthday today, and it's really touching for me to have, because I have, being here, I really have him in my heart, and I would like Jadwiga to know that. About Amelia Hertz, or Hertzówna, as she was called in Poland, she's one of the undiscovered treasures of Polish drama. Born in Warsaw in 1878, she was a Jewish woman living through one of the most turbulent and violent periods in Polish history. Yet her life was one of scholarly and artistic achievement. She was an expert in ancient languages. She traveled widely, living in Switzerland and Germany, before returning to Poland in 1914. But her innovative plays, so far ahead of their time, were largely dismissed and even censored. In the end, her life was cut tragically short. Arrested by the Gestapo in 1941, she died a year later in Nazi German prison. Hertz, in many ways, represents generations of Polish artists affected by social exclusion, political oppression, and war. Her unique voice was nearly silenced, along with so many others whose work has been passed over, forgotten, or even lost forever. For that reason, it is a tremendous achievement to be hearing her plays in English here in New York today. We are so grateful to Jadwiga Kosicka and Frank Henschke of Martin Segal Theatre Center for helping preserve and promote her work. These plays enrich Polish culture, American culture, and world culture. We are very lucky to still have them with us. It is an honor to bring this this incredible woman's work to new audiences today. Amelia Hertz has not been silenced, and we hope her voice will continue to be heard for generations to come. Thank you.
Really, I have been privileged because my privilege was working on many, collaborating on many projects with my mentor, intellectual guide, the best guide I could ever imagine, with whom I shared my life, Daniel Gerald. And before long, and I know he would be very happy to be here because actually he brought me along to keep on and finish my translation that I worked on, put aside, and was in a long, long period. I started work on it in the 90s. And I'll tell you more about it. Of course I know about Hertz. She was present in the history of literature, mentioned that yes, it was a very interesting voice, but her plays were never published, except that they appeared in very small periodicals, elite. And so I didn't know anything. I didn't know the play myself. And after working on various projects in the libraries, and I remember working on the Russian Silver Age and getting bored and irritated with the apocalyptic moods, with Antichrist coming, the end of the world, and so on. I looked for some diversion, and I ordered some of those literary magazines that Hertz actually, her plays were printed, appeared in. And to my surprise, I found a very, very little play, actually dramatic miniature, very refreshing, very unusual, so I started a little, because that was about you, about the reading of her play, please. Isolde of the White Hands. I was familiar again with the Isolde White Hands, but I didn't know too much, so I did some research into the Tristan and Isolde story and all the versions and so on. And it happened that her play was the only, the first play ever that it was removed, the Isolde was removed from the narrative line in all versions of Tristan and Isolde's story, which, by the way, Isolde of the White Hands has not appeared in Wagner's opera, which everybody knows. And it was the first play. And of course, the scholarship on Tristan and Isolde is enormous. It's almost an industry. And again, in the late 90s, there has been enormous interest in the other Isolde, in the White Hands. And Thomas Hardy wrote a play in 1923 that Isolde of the White Hands appeared. And that was promptly made into an opera by William Boughton, a British composer, and it met with enormous enthusiasm and so on. And then I thought, okay, here you have, and that was Amelia Hertz actually did the play, wrote the play 20 years before Thomas Hardy. And so I thought that at least justifying that Hertz will have a niche in Tristan and Isolde scholarship. Anyhow, what I'm going to say now, it will be sounding like a sales pitch, but it isn't. When you undertake any project on people that are absolutely not known, out of mainstream, it's always, whom do I address your work to? What is a possible readership? It's going to have any future? It's going to arouse any interest? So, let me tell a little about myself and why I did that. So I began so-called my career as a translator in the late 80s, working with a variety of forms, letters, essays, fiction, and drama. And although I have been very eclectic in my taste, from the start, my interest has centered on two topics. Polish literature of exile by the uprooted and culturally displaced people, and early 20th century Polish women writers who have been neglected, forgotten, and on the margin. And since I am and always been less interested in the new, but more in what is forgotten, so it fit me very nicely. And at a time now when there is such an enormous and lively industry into reclaiming unjustly forgotten women writers, Amelia Hertz is certainly one of them. And I'm glad to have an opportunity to introduce her to you tonight. And then a justification. Hertz is a discovery on several counts. First, as a playwright who developed a new kind of drama that united the fin de siècle themes and sensibility with intellectual rigor, toughness of mind, and a historian's search for accuracy. But whether dealing with historical or legendary subject, Hertz in her dramas always explores the dark side of the human condition. A generation before Artaud, she created a theater of cruelty, violence, and death set in decadent periods of history that contains a strong existential theme. In the first decade of the 20th century, the modernist period, or if you want to, neo-romanticism, filled with various isms, nobody at that point, I think, wrote plays like hers. And hers represents characters and experiences unexplored by the theater of that time. And her dramaturgical method, characterized by simplicity and sobriety of style that avoids any cloudy mysticism so typical of the turn of the century, and bombastic rhetoric is entirely her own. Then I thought that her, if I thought about reception, possible that her plays are stage worthy. She didn't have any luck in her lifetime, although she considered herself not so much as a scholar, but she wanted always to be a literary person and a writer and a playwright after all. She paid attention to matters of craft and worked carefully on structure of her plays to make them stageable. She wouldn't compromise. She wouldn't use the easy tricks of the professional, so-called professional playwrights for the theater who knew how to appeal to the public and how to secure staging. She wouldn't compromise, she wouldn't go for anything of that sort. She wasn't a part of any movement. She was not a part of a mainstream. So she didn't have any chance. She tried, but she's an extremely busy person doing a scholarly pursuit, simply at certain point, not having any recognition, she simply stopped writing. Her first play was written in 1905. She still was abroad studying. And yes, the literary critics noticed that there is something, a fresh and unusual voice. But of course, that didn't translate into being, you know, considered for any production. She would have to have access to theater circle, to people who were responsible. She didn't have any of that. And the plays, I thought, Hertz plays are generally accessible to Western readers and spectators. Since she used European myth, legend, and history as motives, rather than the specifically Polish national themes that makes the Polish neo-romantic, especially romantic and neo-romantic playwrights so difficult to transfer to translate culturally. Third, which I thought makes worthy attention is her unusual life. It's very, very difficult even to conceive that the person will have such a absolutely unrecorded life. Whatever was gathered about her and details, very scanty details about her life, were actually collected by a short CV she submitted while defending her dissertation in Berlin in 1904. Then from a short letter, actually the only two letters that survived the to our day, which is absolutely incredible. And from some information about her arrest and her death, provided by, I believe, a niece of her who survived the Holocaust. That was all. That was all. And let me tell you, there is we don't know anything about her. There is no photograph or any portrait, no documents, nothing. And what we have, her six plays that have been, that actually appeared in, I believe in 2003 for the first time in Poland in addition. And these are plays. And then her scholarly monographs and articles, which have been published, came out in a variety of scholarly journals and abroad, written in German, French, and Polish, and that were about 40 articles and monographs that appeared in between 1914 and 1939. As Agata mentioned, she was born in 1878 in Warsaw. Her father was a humanitarian doctor and very, very much involved in social work. And she first attended a gymnasium in Poland, born in Warsaw. And then, because of the university that was under Russian partition, the quality of Polish universities at that point, especially in science, is quite low. So Poles usually would go study abroad, mostly in France, and first choice Germany. And since I think it was her family was fairly well off, and perhaps there were some philanthropic things that provided money for expenses while studying there, she went to Berlin. She was at that point 18, and for the next 6 years studied, first in Bern for two semesters. She studied there, apparently in linguistics. Then she switched to Berlin. And that schooling, she attended university in Berlin, it's in Humboldt University, and graduated with doctorate in chemistry. Then in 1905, I suppose, because she was in Paris. Then in 1908, she again went back to Germany and studied in Germany archaeology, Assyriology, Egyptology for another 4 years. then after that, she went to Paris, entered École du Louvre, which she studied again archaeology and languages. In the there is very sketchy things, so we don't know her itineraries or anything of that sort, but apparently she studied in some other academic centers in Germany, in Munich, Leipzig. So it's very baffling because, of course, Berlin and Paris were really capital. Whatever happened at that point, it was Berlin and Paris. We don't know. I think or her archives or anything, the whole family perished during the war in the Holocaust. Perhaps, you know, Warsaw was absolutely, as we know, wiped out of the map, completely destroyed in 1944. She, perhaps, you know, everything just either perished in the fires or so there is nothing. So you really can't know what happened. What did she, what were her readings, whether she attended any theater, what happened that she decided to become, you know, a playwright, whether she, in Paris, there was very lively Polish cultural life, many, many small theaters, whether she attempted to do the Jewish, for example, there are no any records, any correspondence. Perhaps there is some way in the institution, in the university that she worked in. We simply don't know. Anyhow, she wrote plays between 1905 and 1911. She, from time to time, she could back to Poland, and because that's why her plays appeared here and there, and there was a quite favorable reception on the part of the critics. So she may have tried, you know, to interest them, so wasn't leaving her anyway. So she had given up. And of course, when the war broke out, she came back to Poland, apparently, for good, and started to teach in schools. First German languages. Then when the Poland regained independence in 1918, and the situation has changed for the better, for women, for Jews, she decided that perhaps that's what I'm reading, that that's enough. She's going to devote her time and all the energies to her scholarly pursuit and to teaching and to popularizing. So she taught at various schools. She got interested in children's literature. It was easier for people at that point she didn't have to deal with theatrical world or anything of that sort. So she wrote a lot of small play for children and short stories and novellas and that appeared in periodicals and magazines but for children targeted
the children. Then in, of course, that was then she worked in as a teacher in the, one of the so-called flying universities. That was actually a private enterprise called Wolna Wszechnica Polska, which is a free Polish university. A private institution, but with an excellent faculty in sciences, in social sciences, in humanities. And she taught there from 1930 to the war, to the outbreak of the war, teaching the history of writing, archeology, and about ancient civilization. This free university actually went underground when the war broke out. And apparently she continued to teach. And we don't know what happened, because actually she was arrested, apparently transferred to ghetto, whether she was transferred, whether it was forced transfer or she went there voluntarily, because apparently her sister is although there. She got arrested by the Gestapo, moved to Pawiak, notorious Pawiak prison, which was a sort of halfway camp between various concentration camps. The inmates were transferred then to Auschwitz or other camps, or just simply exterminated right in there. So during the war, about 100,000 people got through the Pawiak. 60,000 were transferred to camps, and 37,000 liquidated one way or another. And that's how she perished. I have to mention also that she had some recognition now and then, because of her, she was actually became an active member of the Polish Oriental Society, which was a very significant distinction. And there was an attempt to reintroduce her to the theatrical establishment by an eminent Polish critic, Czechowski, who in an article unknown dramatic poetess, again pointed out the excellence of her work, but it didn't elicit any interest either. So she wrote to thank you letter to the critic, and she said included some biographical information about herself. That's where it was called from, included in reconstructing her biography, the scraps of biography, she said something to the that in he was the first reader of her plays in the past 25 years, and she ended up without any bitterness, you know, that it It's actually, perhaps it had to be that way. What is really very paradoxical and ironic that she wrote about old civilization crumbled, about kingdoms won and lost, about the predicament of our existence, that she had to go through, witness, you know, two, actually, disappearance of the two empires, emergence of the new empires with the seed of destruction already planted in, and then terrible history's hell, that is Holocaust. And one of her plays called Zburzenie Tyru, there is a prophet Ezekiel who prophesied destruction of Tyre, lamenting, you know, the fate of the Jews after when the Babylonians, the destruction of the temple in Jerusalem, and being driven to the Babylonian captivity. Of course, the Babylonian captivity was paled in comparison with the new Babylonians who institutionalized, bureaucratized, and were hell-bent on extermination of the people or culture forever. There is no time, you know, to talk more about her. I'll be happy to answer any questions you may have after the reading. I provided a small introduction. If it sounded like a sales pitch, I would, you know, if it's a sales pitch, it's a gentle pitch, just to get a book and read it. And without too much ado, again, I thank you, and let's go to the end.
Excerpted from the introductory essay by Jadwiga Kosicka in Decadent Histories. Hertz's first play, Isolde of the White Hands, offers an unusual perspective on the well-known medieval Celtic legend of Tristan and Isolde. These Tristan stories were first transmitted by oral tradition and then appeared in a variety of written versions in French, English, and German in the 12th century. Hertz has chosen the second Isolde, Tristan's wife, as the heroine of her drama, not Isolde the Fair, Tristan's paramour. In the legend, Isolde of the White Hands is portrayed as a victim married to a husband who cannot love her. Initially unaware of the cause of her rejection, she suffers in silence and is sadly resigned to her fate until she learns of her rival, Isolde the Fair. Then she strikes back in a fit of jealousy, bringing about the tragic death of the ill-fated lovers. Hertz extends the action beyond the traditional ending and creates a drama focused on Isolde of the White Hands, Tristan's widow, who is living on as the powerful, independent-minded mistress of her castle. The legend of Tristan and his paramour Isolde the Fair enjoyed considerable popularity in the second half of the 19th century thanks to Richard Wagner's 1865 music drama Tristan und Isolde, and to the poetic versions in England by Matthew Arnold, Alfred Lord Tennyson, and Algernon Swinburne. and at the turn of the century, a popular composite reconstruction of the entire legend in modern French prose proved highly influential and was translated into many languages. In the early years of the 20th century, dozens of poems, novels, and poetic verse dramas were written on the subject by women as well as men in England, America, France, and Germany. A few of these authors made Isolde of the White Hands the chief character. She is the heroine of Lesya Ukrainka's 1912 poem, Isolde of the White Hands, of Marie Itzerot's 1916 play, Die Weiße Hand, and of Thomas Hardy's 1923 drama, The Famous Tragedy of the Queen of Cornwall. And she appears in Jean Cocteau's 1943 film, L'Eternel Retour. But Hertz's 1905 version was the first play on the subject, and the only work to explore the perverse psychic disorder of the aggrieved heroine and her ambiguous retributive justice. Hertz treats the story from the point of view of Isolde of the White Hands, and she was the first to give the legend a distinctly modernist and revisionist interpretation that challenges the high-flown poetic tradition. Her drama takes place some years after the purported death of Tristan. In her description of the stage scenery, the playwright immediately establishes the Gothic atmosphere of Isolde's castle. The stage shows a great hall draped in black. A suit of armor belonging to Tristan stands at the entrance, a skull embossed on the helmet, and a battle axe attached to the right glove. The action begins in a scene between the bishop and Lord Caden, Isolde's brother.
I do not know the Duchess.
Really? But you baptized her?
An answer worthy of you. Close the window. It's cold in this accursed castle.
Why are you suddenly so angry?
By St. George, this castle reeks of death! These black draperies, that armor at the entrance, and this silence! You would swear someone is breathing his last in the room next door. I cannot stomach death. Oh, you're laughing. Reach my age and you will laugh at death no more. Oh yes, it's easy to die in battle amidst the clang of arms while thinking only how to inflict death on others. Have you ever seen a corpse beneath a shroud? A rigid cadaver? The folds of the cloth molding its face anew into a white, expressionless mask? I warrant it has never once occurred to you that the moment can approach when you yourself will resemble that shrouded corpse. Tell me, what did you drag me here for?
You've come here of your own free will.
Free will? Free will indeed. I had one groom with me, armed with a stick, to your five knights in full armor, and you call that free will? What are your squabbles and brawls to me? You seek the aid of Roger of Parmeny in your plundering and rape, and I am supposed to persuade your sister to remarry him? That is not a task fit for a dignitary of the church. Widowhood is a blessed and sacred state, by St. Paul in the Epistle to the Corinthians.
I wager my neck, St. Paul never wrote anything of the sort.
Well, maybe not, but what does it matter to you? A skull and a helmet? What's the need of putting human bones on display? But will she listen to me? She wouldn't listen to her own father.
Huh. Have you ever met anyone who would listen to the old Duke? I surely haven't. Soon I'll be locking him up in some dark closet. Shameless.
What are you talking about?
He drinks too much, meddles egregiously with serving girls at his age, and he meddles in my affairs.
You are a bad son, my lord, that I know.
I am. You're fine when you talk about bad sons.
I am ready to speak with the Duchess. I'll try to bend her to your will.
If she were willing to speak to me, I wouldn't need your help. But she refuses. Remember, matchmaker for Tristan.
He weren't very lucky at it, the cur.
The liar, insolent rogue. He swore on his honor as a knight that he no longer loved the other Isolde. Wish I could remember his words. He spoke beautifully. Then, later on, every groom, every page, every peasant knew that he was betraying my sister with that Irish slut who was ready.
Stop it! I am an old man, but I'll enter the lists against you to defend her honor.
I won't fight with you.
Why didn't you challenge Tristan? By St. George, even with those five knights at your side, you wouldn't dare spew that slander of yours if Tristan were still alive.
The Duchess will be here in a moment.
Where was she?
At the grave. She was praying.
So, she's forgiven everything then? I must admit it's difficult for me to believe it. Or to forget, yes, that's possible. But to remember and forgive? That's beyond human strength.
The Duchess is a saint. I used to hate her as the wife of my lord because he didn't love her, but now I would kiss the prince that her feet leave in the sand.
And I could flay you alive for bringing your mistress to ever new tears and sorrow.
It is not my fault that the Duchess refuses to remarry.
Not your fault? Then whose is it, you deceitful panderer?
For the respect I have.
What's this quarrel about? My castle is over roadside inn. Oh, it's you, my brother.
I haven't seen you for 6 months. Pale. You look as if you were hiding some great secret behind those tightly closed lips.
Leave me alone, please. Cordova, why didn't you tell me that Monsieur Caden had come?
He forbade me to mention his name to anyone.
I had to have recourse to coming in order to see you. I missed you so much.
What do you want from me?
I came here accompanied by the bishop. He'll tell you everything.
Forgive me for not greeting you sooner. It is my brother's fault that I did not see you right away.
God be with you, my daughter.
Escort Lord Caden to the dining hall, Cordoval, and have my women wait upon him. At last. What do you wish of me? I am completely at your service.
I have come on the orders of your father.
I see.
You can undoubtedly guess what I want of you. Your father wants you to marry Roger of Parmenie.
I see.
I do not approve of widows remarrying. Widowhood is a blessed and sacred state. But your old father, the Duke, needs tender care and love. If you were to marry Roger, your father would have in you and your husband support and defense against his enemies. You know your brother well enough, I think, to know that he, above all...
Let me open the window. It's stifling in here.
Do as you please. You are alone and childless. That is all right while you are still young. But how will you go on living once your hair turns gray? A lonely old age is old age twice over, Isolde. Who will hold your hand when your last hour has struck? Your servants? They will run away as soon as the power to order them about fails you. And there will be no one to close your eyes when you breathe your last. You'll go through life like a shadow without leaving behind you the slightest memories. There will be no one to pray for you, no one to order a mass to be said for your soul. And who knows how many more years you will have to make atonement in purgatory.
And what if I go to hell?
If I did not know that you were Lord Caden's sister, I would know it by that godless joke.
Forgive me, I have said what was on my mind. And you must pardon me again. I've not seen any people for such a long time. I've forgotten how to receive and entertain a guest like you.
Never mind about that. All I want from you is a clear answer. Will you marry Roger of Parmenie?
No.
Think it over carefully. In a few years, no one will desire you as a wife.
As long as the castles and the lands I inherited from my mother are in
one
my...
One would think that you were mourning the most faithful and excellent of husbands. Every trouvère sings of the love of Tristan of Lyonesse for the Queen of Cornwall. And yet you remain faithful to him even after his death? Now that Tristan was the most beautiful and valiant of knights, but he wronged you.
He wronged me.
So you feel it yourself?
He wronged me. Why did he come and make me love him? Before I met him, there was not a human being, not a flower, not a song. Not a moment of the day that did not have some portion of my love. But afterwards, I loved only him. And everything else was nothing to me. And I was nothing without him.
Even after his death, you can't forget him.
But he was my life and soul. For years, I sat here by that window, looking out on the highway leading to the north. My heart and my eyes were embedded in those cobblestones of that road, along which he was to return. And when it grew dark, I would close my eyes, because they could no longer see him. And I would tremble at the slightest clang of the sentry's arms, at every howling of a dog or neighing of the horses for long, long years. Do you understand? And he would come back from time to time. And then he would close his eyes as I did and kiss my lips and call Isolde. Destroyed my life in order to be able to call his wife Isolde, the other one's name. Must all this cease to be, to die without a trace? All my frightful pain, all my humiliation, all my love, and the long years I wandered here in this castle was all. Am I to wipe it all out of my life and forget? No. No, I cannot forget.
Life is long, Isolde, but youth is short. Look at me. I too was young once. I have loved and I have hated. I was famous and I was brave and my arms were strong. And so was my mind. And now, I remember nothing of it. And even if memory brings me back a moment out of the past, it seems to me it is rather a remembered chapter from a book of chivalry I once read, not from my own life. Everything is subject to forgetting.
You once were Lord George of Dulay, that's true. But didn't you have enemies you hated with every drop of blood in your body, with every breath, with every thought, enemies who would appear by your bed in your dreams and whose lives weighed on your chest like a heavy stone? Didn't you have such enemies?
No man is without enemies. I had mine.
Did you kill them?
Yes, perhaps I did.
But not at once, not immediately. Perhaps you'd make careful plans to set a trap. You'd send spies to find out when your enemies would leave their castles, and you'd wait for them in ambush in the forest. Or perhaps, to your indescribable joy, you'd meet them on the battlefield. You'd recognize them not by their colors and their armor, but by the beating of your heart. Did you slay them right then and there? Or did you prolong their agony?
I was a great sinner, but you are not entitled to remind me of my sins. I would so like to forget.
Those are the most beautiful memories of your life.
Isolde.
But you see, I was not able to avenge myself. I had to wait patiently until God took pity on me and sent him to my chamber in the throes of death. Oh, I think I could have stood by his bed for years on end and looked into his despairing eyes when I told him the black sails were flying on Corneval's ship. Oh, if just once again I could hear her cries over his dead body. I never heard cries like that in my entire life. I thought I would die from happiness, as she did from grief.
You are a frightful woman, Isolde. I'm not surprised that your husband abandoned you. Your heart is a nest of vipers.
It is his fault. My heart was once like a garden, full of fragrant flowers. It was sad and sweet and, oh, like the setting sun. Haven't they wronged me?
One should forgive.
I cannot forgive. Even at the hour of my death, I shall not forgive. Even if I am damned for all eternity, I cannot forgive. Haven't they wronged me?
Yes, the wrong they did you was great. But leave the dead in peace. Look, the flowers are blooming on their graves. The roses have twined around their tombs. Forget them. Someday the roses could flower for you, too, as they do for that dead pair.
The roses on their graves, and traveling trouvère sings of the roses on the grave of Tristan of Lyonesse and Isolde of Cornwall. Every trouvère sings of their love. But I swear, had they not died, no one would sing of Tristan and the Queen of Cornwall, but only of the revenge of Isolde of the White Hands, of my revenge.
Even if you had killed them with your own hand, even if you had murdered them, inflicting upon them tortures so terrible that no one until then had ever dared use them, they would be dead by now anyway, and your revenge could only sate itself on their graves. You must stop lamenting for sins you never committed.
They would be dead by now anyway. Say. So for all of you with your hearts of barbarians, killing is vengeance. Exterminate the enemy! Ha! Oh no, let him live and suffer. Let him know that only death can put an end to his agony. And let him fear death the way only the truly miserable can fear it. I once used to fear dying.
No, I won't stay here another moment. I don't want to talk with you. Get out. Send for other people. Do you hear me? I order you!
No, you have to hear me to the end. But what if they hadn't died then? What if I had ordered empty coffins put into the ground? I am absolute sovereign here in my castle, and only Corneval could have betrayed me, and you know how easy it is to seal human lips forever. And then?
And then?
Have you ever seen the dungeons beneath this castle? They are so deep that the sound of a stone falling to their bottom cannot be heard. And so dark that you must hold a torch close to the face of a prisoner in order to see his eyes. When I go down into those subterranean chambers, I feel such a weight on my chest. I have the impression I'm being buried alive. And yet I often go down into the dungeons.
Alone?
and sets up his instruments of torture down there. I swear no one is being tortured. I'm the only one who moans. And my voice echoes against the walls of the prison. No, there's no arm down there straining under the irons and vainly trying to break the chains which keep it fastened to the stones of the dungeon. But the clanking of manacles is heard. It's only because a menial has dropped them. There's never anyone down there but the two of us. Me and the executioner. And sometimes one of my servants comes with me with her lover, and then I can hear their sighing. And the broken whispers of love. I swear to you, I don't know who is howling down in the darkness in an inhuman voice. I don't know. But perhaps.
Stop talking in whispers!
Even a whisper can be heard down there. Did you know that the dungeon is right below this chamber? Often I sit here and have the traveling Juvert sing songs, but only of Tristan and Isolde. And down there they can hear the singing. And I have the impression that they are digging the fingers of their chained hands into the walls. And the entire castle trembles from their hopeless anguish over the past.
Stop that! They are here in the castle?
What an idea! Weren't the bodies lying in the chapel with the faces uncovered? Even if they were alive now, no tortures could force me to disclose this secret. Anyway, wouldn't they have found liberators? Do you think those two hideous skeletons would still love each other if they met now? Wouldn't that be the worst form of punishment for them to see each other now? I'm ready to take you down into the dungeon so you can see for yourself there's no one down there.
No, I don't want to let Lord King go with you.
That would be too great a temptation for me. I might keep him down there for good.
Your own brother?
Why did he fail to defend my rights, brother to me, but friend to Tristan? Why didn't he avenge me while there was still time? Why didn't he slay Tristan in her arms? I think nothing would be lacking to make my happiness complete if he were down in the dungeons with them.
You speak as if they were still alive.
Even after dying, they lived on, feasting like vampires on the blood of my heart. But now they are dead. While I was talking to you, they began to pale and breathe their last. They vanished and won't come back again, but who knows? I may set off with them. Pray that you retire. I cannot stay any longer.
Go there.
Isolde leaves. While passing by Tristan's armor, she leans against it. The battle axe becomes detached and falls to the floor.
They are here in the castle!
What an idea. Wasn't it Corneval who welcomed you on the drawbridge? If Corneval is alive, his lord cannot possibly be in the dungeons of my castle.
Well, that's true. I forgot about him.
And as for Corneval, you know, you were right when you said old age is a time of forgetting. Despite all the despair he felt, Corneval would have forgotten Tristan and even grown accustomed to the sight of the skull on his helmet. But I am constantly with Corneval, and every day my words tear open the wound in his bleeding heart. Every day I remind him of his lord and crying myself, I watch the tears streaming down his wrinkled old face, and the immense helpless despair my heart overflows with joy.
Well, have you spoken with my sister?
Spoken with your sister? No. It was the devil incarnate who spoke with me tonight.
Thank you all so much. Thank you for staying, and we're gonna have a little discussion again. An applause for the actors and for the directing. I think it was quite a traumatic reading, a sense of a traumatic reading. Maybe go a little closer, since we are not so many. Jadwiga and Jane, if you would like to come and join. Jadwiga, maybe you sit in the middle.
Okay.
And. So, first of all, Jadwiga, how does it feel like listening? Is this the first reading, perhaps, ever of the text?
Well, apparently in the late 50s, there was a radio reading, but of course I don't know what it sounded like. Or mm-hmm. And yes, I think it's the first reading, because in Poland, you see Hertz's plays are treated as a literary, not theater piece. From the, since there was no single production, except I think in 75, another of her long play, A Great King, about Byzantium, which was apparently quite inept, and that was it. And so I was just very, very curious how it will sound, because I tried to think when I was translating to hear it, you know, whether it would be effective or not. Because I think it's a marvelous play, and it would be again a wonderful chamber opera if it's an ideal libretto for it. Anyhow, by the way, explanation, Hertz used the story of Tristan and Isolde enjoying tremendous popularity at the turn of the century due to a compiled version, prose version, of Joseph Bedier, a French medievalist who taught at the Collège de France. And it all indicates that Hertz was familiar with that version, and that she may have heard him actually at the College of France lecturing. This version, which he, Bedier, did some extent in fragmented parts of the Tristan and Isolde stories, actually it went apparently, because some scholars of Tristan and Isolde, some scholar accountant, went into trouble to actually find out how many, apparently from the turn of the century to the 90s of this, there were 600 editions in many, many translations, every conceivable language there is. And apparently Hertz read it, because actually as a motto, I could, I would just quote a line from Badia translation, Badia story. It sounds of that sort, not of that kind. Now a woman's wrath is a fearful thing, and all men fear it, for according to her love, so her vengeance will be. Isolde of White Hands. This is very interesting because whether it's a reality, whether it's her hallucination, whether she is in a trance, spinning scenarios, what she would do and how would she do and whether they are alive or not. Even Bishop gets very confused about it. She draws into her madness. Is she mad? Isn't she mad? Her revenge and her vengeance was so much more frightful and so deep that she felt betrayed by everybody. It's a very strong woman. Again, all the debates whether Hertz was a feminist or not, all her women are very strong, very proud, much more than the male characters. And of course, she couldn't forgive her brother that she was kept in the dark, because she didn't know about Isolde of the Fair until the very end. And again, her marriage, she loved him very deeply, was not consummated. And that's why they're talking about sanctity of the widowhood, because then she was supposed to either marry or go enter a convent and serve another lord, that is the eternal lord. Yeah. The situation of women in the 12th century was surprisingly good. They could inherit property, which was in her case, that she inherited property after her mother, plus whatever Tristan had. She was his wedded wife, so it was a natural. And in the play, there is a domestic drama going on, because Cadin doesn't want to take any responsibility for his father, who is apparently a drunk and chaser of servant girl, lecherous, awful. And so if she remarried, apparently she would had to take care of her father, and Cadin would be free. She wouldn't have it, absolutely not. She wouldn't remarry. She doesn't want to go into any bondage again and be betrayed. Again, she accuses Cadin that he didn't revenge her, that he didn't tell her that about the other Isolde. And there is a beautiful line, very poetic in Badia version, that she is actually with Cadin, Isolde with the White Hands. They are going fording some stream, and the water splashes on her thighs. she is very delighted. And she says to Kerdin, my husband never went that far, never reached that far. And again, Kerdin didn't say anything. He was startled by the news, but did nothing. She celebrated her dispersion. The story goes as follows. Yes, Tristan, on his deathbed, summons his old affair, so she would cure him. She would, if she comes, he would recover. And Isolde of Weihans, by that time, she overheard the conversations and she figures out that she lived for so many years, betrayed, loved, and they got nothing in kind. So when she sees, you know, the sails and that the fair is coming, she runs and tells Isolde that unfortunately Tristan had died. Isolde is crushed, but goes back to Cornwall. And then Tristan learns of the betrayal. So he rushes to Cornwall to see his Isolde, although he is dying apparently. And Mark, the king and husband of Isolde Fair, kills him in a fit of jealousy. Isolde grabs the weapon out of Mark's hand, stabs herself and dies also. And Isolde of the White Hands goes back to Brittany. And the story ends.
So it is truly, in Amelia Hertz's version, quite a tale of revenge. Sure. And in her indifference to suffering, she's almost angelic, I think. And but a very strong, as you said, female role, unusual, and as you said, that would be a quite astonishing opera. But Jane, our question to you, I know that you all had the idea actually also to direct plays of her, or especially this play. What was your motivation? What did you like about it? Why did you think this is a good, this I would like to direct?
Well,
The microphone.
It is a wonderful, they're all very interesting roles, every single one of them, the four of them. And she says very, very succinctly what each character is, each character's role in the play. She brings them in. So I loved. Even Lord Caden, you get a very clear idea of who he's supposed to be, even though he only has maybe 20 lines. So there's a lot the actor can bring to that. And then, of course, there's this wonderful scene between the bishop and Isolde, where she explores her inability. Well, she explores the past and her inability to let go of the past. And for me, it was a great deal of play about forgiveness. That she is unable to forgive. The bishop too is unable to he's unable to forget. He says, I wish I could forget. I mean, he does have a line about that. So for me, that was very important. Those two, the ability to forgive was a very important part of the play, because Isolde really, she can't forgive, so she goes mad. She plays over and over in her mind she tortures herself with this, these memories, and there's nothing she can do about them. I mean, the bishop is very right in his, he's sort of a a therapist in a modern way. And of course, Freud and was quite popular at this time. He was coming up in importance at this time. So I like that, the fact that you know, these very interesting psychological threads were happening at the time, also with Dr. Charcot and his investigation of hysteria. So, and then there is also...
Put the mic a bit
closer. I'm sorry, there is also this wonderful part of it. You know, it's sort of grand guignol. There's a playing on people's terror. And that's very popular today. By the way, I did a lot of looking at dungeons on the web. And there's an amazing number of web things. If you want to look at dungeon sounds and dungeons and people hanging from, you know, chains and things, there's a lot of that on the web. So, you know, it's a very timely play.
Yes, it's contemporary.
It has a lot to say about today, even though it's set back in the Middle Ages.
Well, whether it's said to have a place in the Byzantium in the 6th century,
right,
and they are in the 15th century, they are not antiquarian at all.
We wanted to do
contemporary.
Yes. Yeah. We wanted to do a play that was, you know, the other plays are longer. There was one play, the Fleur-de-Lis, which was short, but the characters in it is an 8-year-old girl, so that would have been a little, you know, a little bit difficult to manage. Anyway, we decided against that, and that's why we decided on this play.
And of course, I think Jan Kott was the one who said theater is a place between the living and the dead, where the ghosts come, and she's ghost-like presence. Whether she is, you know, she exists or not, like in a Beckett play where, you know, in footfalls, you know, where is she alive, is she not? Are these people alive, are they not? But perhaps foreshadowing her own fate and the fate of Poland, you know, of being betrayed by so many parts of the world, and whether one can forgive or not for such betrayal. And her, of course, whatever the feeling, the greatest betrayal is about love, and that her real pure love and was betrayed. But we have 5-6 more minutes left, maybe one or two questions from the audience. Yuchen, we'll give you a microphone. It's also live streamed, or not, it's also for a little archival university archive. So please do take the microphone, and there's one question over here.
Oh, this is a splendid work, but I'm familiar, like I guess most people are, with the versions in Chrétien de Troyes and then Joseph Béguet,
yes,
and the translation of Edward Arlington Robinson. But this one is, I was wondering if it is it contemporary with that Béguet, or is it come after Béguet?
Béguet came out in 1900.
Oh, so and the Robinson translation, I think the Edward Arlington Robinson, he's a Frenchman.
French, yes.
Yeah, so but I think Robinson translated it for the American audience, Edward Arlington Robinson.
Oh, yes, but there was immediately in 1903 translation by Hilaire.
Well, maybe I'm wrong
Bellot.
About Robinson. No, oh, so okay. He might, but it's not about literary history, but
yes.
But this play astonishes me by the... by the cruelty of her version.
Yes.
All the other versions, and I believe with Chrétien de Troyes, and then of course Wagner, and then Béguet version, which I kind of grew up with. The tragedy is compensated for by the aestheticism. Let's
yes.
say in Wagner. But this is so stark, it's like a forerunner of, let's say, Artaud's play about the Cenci.
Oh, yes,
yeah,
that's exactly,
so this is really
exactly
hot stuff.
That is.
I loved it, but
yeah.
it is something special. It is sort of like deconstructing Tristan through Freud
Yes, and the interesting thing is that actually in the old version, is all the of white hands just informs Tristan that the sails are black, and he dies, and she doesn't have any line spoken, actually. So she, Hertz actually takes her as a true heroine, because, you know, she said, okay, Isolde of the White Hands, if it weren't for her, they would have died. The story would be like any story, any love story, and the true verse wouldn't be thinking about her.
Hell had no fury.
Yes, nothing, nothing.
Thank you, thank you. Another comment or over there?
Thank you. First of all, the actors did a marvelous job, Jane. Really, really.
Yes, they did.
The flavor was absolutely there. But I found something very interesting in the psyche of the woman. When she says, before she knew Tristan, she loved everything. The love of the child of life, mm-hmm. or of the young woman of life,
the
all
innocent.
The life that's around
innocent.
Her. And then this man enters her life, and he sort of sucks up everything,
exactly.
only then to be betrayed. So her,
yes.
her recognition of the before and after,
mm-hmm.
and this absolute betrayal is stunning in this play, in its kind of a logic that she exposes here. She exposes really the that sense which I'm sure would horrify many men, mm-hmm. but that is very deep inside, that the ultimate betrayal is not so much that she's betrayed, that this man goes off with somebody else, but that it is also a betrayal of her very being.
Yes.
Yes, I understand. I think that's a very good point.
Thank you.
Yes, it is a very good point. She is a living corpse. Everything, every emotion is killed in her except vengeance. She says she enjoys seeing Carnival suffering. It fills her with joy because she's not, she just wants absolute revenge for her life destroyed. That's it.
Maybe one more comment or question, yeah, over there.
I wanted to ask on the particular challenges of translating
yes.
Hertz's work.
Particular
challenges.
In general, what were tough?
Well,
what were you wrestling with?
Well, I think that unlike many turn of the century pieces, her are very tight, very logical. Even in a madness, there is a palpable logic, right? You could feel it. It's a simplicity. She is very, economy of her plays is just admirable. You know, you really, they are constructed without, I think, any fault whatsoever. There is no unneeded word. And so the challenge is to actually hear it, how it would sound on stage. So you have to read it aloud or whatever, yes. But, well, yes, with some there are to keep, because her, actually her research and her knowledge about just incredible erudition. She covered that, she wrote a play about 18th century England with all the details, absolutely impeccable. For example, she makes a distinction. She doesn't use troubadour. she uses trouvère. And of course you find out that troubadours were in the south of France. This is Brittany, and there were trouvères. And the trouvères were called more sophisticated, perhaps, and with the better musically trained and so on. So it's trouvère. So she did, you have to check everything. And I read, of course, I followed all her possible sources, what she could have read and what she used, and to be as exact and as true as she was to the epoch that she was describing. And that is true about everything. Of course, I can talk about, you know, I could with the Byzantium, that's my
bad.
Byzantium, but again, which I did research when translating about Gilles de Rais, she used actual sources. It was, again, a very big craze about Gilles de Rais. It was a story about serial murderer and so on. So she used, appeared at transcripts, actually, of the Gilles de Rais trial. And she used that. And some extensive reading of the contemporary writing of scholarship on the 15th century. So you have to be very careful, because you have to be actually respect her. You have to follow and not to be unfaithful, because I could feel that it would be revenge too.
Put you in the dungeon.
Yeah. Oh yes.
Yeah. So I would say it is truly. I think it was a truly respectful and great translation. I think spirit was shining through her idea, and this idea of a deconstruction, which we said earlier, I think now we know Wicked, you know, where you take a story apart and look at it from another side. But for her to do that so early on and creating someone unsympathetic, but who we can somehow relate to more, you know, than to the lovers, that is quite an achievement. We are close here to the end of the evening. We actually already a little bit over time. Jadwiga and Jane will be here a little bit longer. And so stay with us for a glass of wine for the Isolde of the White Hand. Again, it's a great, great honor, even so we are very few. But what does a few mean? The last episode of Friends was watched by 25 million people. And if we had here 10 or 100 or 1,000, what is it? Really, I just think we really honored a great writer who's living, whose work is now still in the dark and brought it into light, and it's a great achievement. And we would like to thank Jadwiga for doing this, as you know, parts of her life's work, as she said. So our highest respect for what you did, and I think this will be an inspiring evening. And I my guess is we have not heard the last of Amelia Hertz, and things will come. And I'm sure one composer, one of those days, will put it into a work where it will have a form. And put some hot water into that beautiful tea that she put together. So thank you all, and
amazing thing about her plays is that they are absolutely open to a myriad of possible interpretations. So it's absolutely amazing.
Thank you all, and thank you for coming. Thank you for staying. Thank you.